Jay here for Stretford Paddock. This is the Paper Talk. We're live, as you can see. We're in the studio, not outside Old Trafford, but we're going back there soon. So we're doing live from the studio. So do get involved in the chat. Do hit like as well and get involved in the comments. Let us know what you think about the latest stories. And if you've got any new Manchester United stories, because we know you guys have always got your finger on the pulse. Now, as you may have seen from the thumbnail, from the title, United and PSG could be going head-to-head for a midfielder. Young lad called Romain Faivre. I think that's how you pronounce his name. There's been reports in France, and this has been picked up by the English media, that both Manchester United and Paris Saint-Germain are interested in the 22-year-old. Now, believe it or not, I don't know a lot about him, but I've been doing a little bit of research, and it looks like he's highly regarded. He's had a relatively productive season, 19 appearances for Brest, 4 goals, 3 assists. Now, he was at Monaco. He went to Brest. Well, I think it was only around 450,000 euros or 450,000 quid that he moved for. But he has been doing very well there. Brest are sort of mid-table in League One, but he's been one of their shining stars. And it looks like he's getting noticed. He's getting noticed by the big guns, and Paris Saint-Germain and Manchester United are both interested in him, which means that Ole Gunnar Solskjaer and Maurizio Pochettino could be going head-to-head for the youngster. Now, from what I've seen, he can play as an attacking midfielder, a defensive midfielder. He's sort of, I don't want to use the term jack of all trades because that makes it sound like, you know, master of none. But he can sort of play all around the midfield area, but he is primarily a central midfielder. Now, this sort of fits in with the policy or the strategy that we've seen Manchester United adopting recently, where it's a sort of, we're going for the younger players. We're going for players that are sort of expected to do great things in the next couple of seasons, on the cusp of greatness, shall we say, but it'll be all grandiose, rather than players that are established. Now, yes, we've bought Edinson Cavani, who's probably the most established striker in world football. Donny van der Beek, who was pretty established. But if you look at Amad Diallo, you look at Facundo Pelestre, you look at the other players we've been linked with, Moises Caicedo, this lad as well, now seems to fit that bill where we're looking at younger players, players that are a lot more affordable, players that, okay, they might not be established, there might be a bit more of a risk involved, but if you spend sort of 5, 10, 15 million on a player plus add-ons, then it's not as much of a risk if you spend 40, 50 million on a player who may or may not make the grade. So this seems to be the sort of newish Manchester United tactic. Now, we've seen this before with transfers at Manchester United. I always revert back to the story about, well, not the story, the time in 2003, around that year, that summer, when Manchester United looked at it and decided to adopt a slightly different approach. Chelsea just inherited a load of money. Clubs were spending money left, right and centre. And United decided to change tack slightly. We brought in a load of youngsters. We brought in the likes of Liam Miller, rest in peace. Brought in the likes of, I think it was David Bellion, Eric Dijemba, Cleberson, all these young up-and-coming players. And Cleberson was a bit more established, but young players. We also brought in a certain Cristiano Ronaldo, and that worked out well. So I don't know. Maybe that is the sort of thing we're looking at now, where we're bringing in one or two youngsters. Yes, we'll still make signings and we'll still make big, big money signings, but it seems it's being augmented. They're being augmented with more of the younger players, with these sort of starlets, especially from the continent, who are highly regarded. We spoke to Fabrizio Romano last week on the Tier 1 podcast with myself and Ronaldo Brown, and he was saying about Amad Diallo, United's new signing, obviously, from last week. We got that deal done, that he was surprised that someone like a Juventus didn't come in. And he said it was a really smart move by Manchester United getting him, because he'd been speaking to people at Atalanta, who raved about this kid, who said he's quality, he's a talented youngster, he's doing stuff in the youth team and in training that is really amazing, was the words that he used. And he thought it was a really good move for Manchester United to get in there early. Not to wait till he played more games, because I know a few people were looking at it going, hang on a minute, this kid has played, what, 4 games for Atalanta, and we're paying what could with add-ons amount to, I think it's said it could amount to 40-odd million if he fulfills all the add-ons, but you're talking about if he plays hundreds of games and wins Ballon d'Ors and all that stuff. So he said it was a really smart move, and he was surprised that, like I said, other clubs aren't coming for him. And maybe that's what Manchester United are doing with this kid. Okay, Paris Saint-Germain are also looking at him, so we may have to go toe-to-toe with them, which isn't great because they've got almost unlimited funds. Maurizio Pochettino as well, just come in there. He'll be wanting to be backed in the transfer market. He'll have his targets. He'll want the players in that he wants. So it could be one of those where Manchester United look at it, make a bid or don't make a bid based on what Paris Saint-Germain are doing, because what you wouldn't want to do is end up in a massive bidding war with him, because they can just sort of spend 30, 40, 50 million and not even think about it. And unfortunately, Manchester United, with Glazernomics the way they are, we're just not able to do that. And to be honest with you, even if it wasn't for the Glazers, who I've got no time for, I don't expect us to. I don't expect us just to be dropping 40, 50 million on a kid who's played 90 games in League One. Well, 90 games this season where he's impressed in League One. It is a bit of an ask. So I sort of understand that, why it may be one of those where you look at it, you see whether you can get him for sort of around a £10 million mark. And if not, then you move on and look at other targets. But he's one to keep an eye on. Romain Faivre. Guys, do get involved in the comments. Let us know if you've seen much of him, what you think of this idea about buying younger players, whether you think it's worth our while going head-to-head with PSG. Or should we do that? Should we say, you know what? Just because PSG are interested in a player doesn't mean we should drop out. You know, we're Manchester United. We're a big club. We're one of the biggest clubs in the planet. We're certainly a bigger club than Paris Saint-Germain. And we should be going for the talent that we want. And we shouldn't be certain getting put off 22-year-olds who've barely played just because Paris Saint-Germain are going in. So let us know what you think. Hit like as well, guys. Hit that like button. And I will be getting involved into the comments and letting us know what you think. I saw someone saying no weather reports. They know I don't do the weather reports when I'm inside. But don't worry, when we're back at Old Trafford, I will be getting into that. Let us know as well whether you feel that midfield is the area we should be looking at someone. It's a bit of a funny one with midfield because we've got lots of midfielders, really, when you think about it. We've got some good quality midfield. We've got Pogba, you've got Fernandes, you've got Matic, you've got Donny van der Beek, you've got Scott McTominay, you've got Fred. The problem is, how many of those now are fully, right, that's it, he's in the team no matter what. There's only probably Bruno Fernandes. Even Pogba sometimes gets dropped, and it's not just when he's injured and not fit. Sometimes it's tactical. So it's like we need a midfielder perhaps that's going to come in and stake a claim. And I don't know if a 22-year-old will do it. So what that looks like is another lad who's one for the future. And you may look at it and go, well, we've already got players that, you know, are for the future or fringe players. Do we need to go out and buy a midfielder who can come in and be ready, who's ready to come straight into that first team and probably do a job as a central defensive midfielder, DM, a CDM, if you will. I think Devin Edwards in the comments has just said, we need a proper CDM, just replicating what I've just said, to replace Matic. That's the problem. We've got Nemanja Matic. He signed a new deal. I think it was a three-year deal? But he's not an old man by any stretch of the imagination, but he's 30-odd. I think he's 31, is he, Matic? So, you know, you have to ask yourself, how long has he got? Oh, sorry, 32. I'm doing, I'm taking a year off him there. He's 32 years old. So you probably do need someone a bit more long-term, but what do you want? Someone who's very long-term, or do you want someone who can come in next season? United Forever podcast says Jimmy Garner. Yep, Jimmy Garner, great player. You know, one for the future. I've seen him play for the under-23s a couple of times. Definitely think he's got a future at the club. But again, he's not going to come in and straight away do a job. He's not going to be starting next season, I don't think. I think it might be a couple of seasons before we see anything of James Garner. So keep your eye on Romain Faivre. One to watch. We're in for him, apparently. Looking at him, so Paris Saint-Germain. Could be a bit of a bidding battle that goes on there. Hopefully, though, if we do want him, we'll get him. Let's move on. Also, we're going to be looking at, well, you know, we've got a game against Burnley this week. A top-of-the-table clash against Burnley. Manchester United, tomorrow night, Tuesday night, travelling to Turf Moor to take on Sean Dyche's team. And it seems we may have one or two injury worries. It's been it almost feels like a while since we've had a massive, massive injury worries. Well, don't worry, they're back again. Amongst the players that are doubtful for tomorrow night's game is Paul Pogba. I mentioned him earlier. He's a bit of an injury worry. He may not be fit for tomorrow night. There's the reports, I think it's Sky Sports are running reports, that he's a doubt for the game against Burnley on Tuesday. He's not the only one, but apparently he's one of three players that could be missing through injury. We know Paul Pogba this season, he had a bit of a ropey start. We know he was suffering from COVID, so there's a reason behind that. I'm not going to be too harsh on the lad. But he's come back into the team, and I think recently he's been performing at a much higher level. I thought the derby, the second half, I thought he played well, not much in the first half, but over the last sort of few weeks, he has been one of our better players. So you want your better players fit because, you know, we're in a title race at the minute. It doesn't matter whether you think we're going to win a title or not. We're right up there. We're in a title race. So you want your players fit and you need Paul Pogba firing on all cylinders. Now, we do have the game against Liverpool coming up as well at the weekend. So the fact that someone's missing for the Burnley game isn't the end of the world because, as I mentioned earlier, we've got options in midfield. So if he's missing for the Burnley game, okay, the big question is, can he come back in for the Liverpool game? Because that would be, you know, the bigger one. But he's not the only one who's missing as well. Apparently, Luke Shaw is another one who's doubtful. Luke Shaw, who's a bit Marmite, isn't he, Luke Shaw? Some people rave about him. Some people say he's, you know, he's hit the form that he had before he had suffered that horrific injury against PSV, the ankle injury. Others are saying he's not quite up to the job. He's not good enough. Alex Telles is better, that sort of thing. Let us know what you think, guys, about Luke Shaw. Let us know what you think about Paul Pogba in the comments as well. But Luke Shaw has been playing a lot of football this season. You can see from the graphic there, 12 matches he's played. And he's been playing relatively well. I think, he's been quite effective. So I think that you want him. You want him to be available. You want all your players to be fit. So he's another one, along with Paul Pogba, who could be out for the Burnley game as well. And he's not the only one. There's also Victor Lindelof. He's a doubt as well. So we said there was three players. The third one is Victor Lindelof. He's been, he's another one suffering with what's been sort of a doubt. Excuse me. A doubt. He could be out as well. So you're looking at Paul Pogba, Victor Lindelof, and Luke Shaw as your three players that are out. Now that is a worry because obviously when everyone's fit, you could argue that all three of them start. Now with Victor Lindelof, it's a bit of a funny one because Eric Bailly came in. And he's been doing really well. He's been playing really well. And we saw the game against Aston Villa in particular, where he's fantastic. So many people are saying, well, okay, is Victor Lindelof even a first teamer now when everyone's fit? You could argue that Eric Bailly is. And I get that. Again, you could argue that when everyone's fit, you might prefer Alex Telles over Luke Shaw. You could even argue for the big games, you might not even play Paul Pogba. I'm not saying I wouldn't, but you might say, oh, well, Ollie likes his two older midfielders. So there's a case to be made that none of these, or at least some of them aren't all first-teamers, but it is a bit of a worry with the games coming thick and fast when three of your players are out as well, and especially against Burnley, it can be a tricky side. So get involved in the comments. Let us know what you think. United Forever podcast asking about Dylan Levitt being recalled. Yep, there was he was out on loan, wasn't he, Dylan Levitt? He's been, obviously... I think this was a couple of days ago this was announced. He went out to Charlton, but United activated the recall option in his clause. He wasn't the only one as well. There was also the young keeper as well, Matej Kovar, who returned from his spell at Swindon. I think it's just a lack of games. I think that United were unhappy with the amount of games are going. These lads are going out there on loan to get game time. If they're not getting him, then Ole Gunnar Solskjaer, as he's right to do, is going to recall him, because the whole point of him going to these clubs, to places like Swindon and Charlton, is to get match experience, to get first team experience at that level, to get some sort of fitness and just match sharpness. If they're not going to get that, then you may as well recall them, because there's no point in just letting players go out on loan just to sit on the bench or just to join in the training. No disrespect at Charlton's training or at Swindon Town's training. They're better off being at Manchester United and being in and around the first team here, or even playing for the under-23s if they're not going to get any games there. So that's what seems to be the deal with those players. Well, with Dylan Levitt, I know you asked about Dylan Levitt, but I also threw in the keeper as well, because he's another one. Moving on, should we have a Jadon Sancho story? I feel like we've not had one for about an hour. Now, I don't know if you've heard of Jadon Sancho. He's this player that we went for in the summer, and basically every day there was a new Jadon Sancho story about he's coming, Manchester United are going to buy him, Manchester United have agreed terms with Jadon Sancho, Borussia Dortmund are resigned to the fact that they're going to lose Jadon Sancho, Borussia Dortmund have issued their statement saying they're not going to sell Jadon Sancho, Borussia Dortmund have named a price for Jadon Sancho. It went on and on and on and on. And as you all know, Jadon Sancho ended up staying at Borussia Dortmund. Now, he's not had the best of seasons. You can see on the graphic there that his season this season hasn't been as nearly as prolific and productive as it was last season. Look at last season, he played 32 games, he scored 17 goals, 18 assists. Fantastic. This season, he's played 13 games. He's got 16 assists, sorry, last season. 13 games this season, 2 goals and 5 assists. My eyesight is shocking. So he's had a bit of a patchy start, shall we say. It's not been dreadful. I mean, 7 goal involvements, as people like to say, in 13 games is hardly horrific. But he's not putting up the sort of numbers that he was last season. And there's been a general feeling that he isn't quite performing to the standard that he was. And he's been speaking about that. And saying that, he rues that, and he's given an interview for Bundesliga.com, which is obviously, does what it says on the tin, covers the Bundesliga. He says, obviously this season has been very difficult for me personally. So I knew when I went away, I just focused on my game and came back raring to go when he obviously was out for a little bit, come back. I'm working very hard in every day in training and on the pitch. So I'm just happy to get my goals and assists. Now, he has been playing better recently. He got a good goal the other week, I think it was last week. So it's not all, you know, a case of Jadon Sancho's gone completely off the boil. I think there was a lot of sort of talk that he'd been unhappy. He was miffed that he hadn't got that move to Manchester United. As I said earlier, we covered it, everyone covered it. It looked like it was nailed on. It was going to happen. He was going to go to Manchester United, but come to Manchester United, didn't happen. Didn't come. Jason Sanchez in the comments. People saying in the comments, Jason Sanchez. Yes, that's how he's known, Jason Sanchez. But yeah, it didn't happen. And his form suffered a little bit. People saying that his head was turned and that maybe that's why, because he just was sort of upset that he didn't get his move to Manchester United and hadn't been performing to the levels he'd been replicating the season before. But he seems to have cracked on with it now. And as I said earlier, his form isn't that bad. We were speaking to, as I said, just before Fabrizio Romano, he was saying that, you know, don't be surprised if Manchester United go back in with Jadon Sancho. He fully expects that to happen this summer. It doesn't see it happening in January. And I don't think anyone did think we'd go in for him in January. But he said, in the summer, expect us to go back in for Jadon Sancho. But he did say that there could be other suitors involved because United had a pretty clear run at Jadon Sancho last summer. There was only us who were in for him. We knew the price. The problem was, you know, Dortmund wanted, I think, 120 million euros. United weren't willing to pay that. United also citing the fact that, you know, we're in the middle of a pandemic. They had took a hit financially. Now, I'm not going to defend the Glazers because I can't stand them and they took so much money out of the club. It's a joke. But I can understand Manchester United not wanting to pay 120 million euros on a player during a pandemic. And a player as well who is very good, Jadon Sancho. He's a supreme talent, but it's still a bit of a risk. You know, he's never really played in the Premier League. I know he was at City. And yes, he's a talent, but, you know, he's quite a lot of money for someone who's performed in the German League, which isn't always a great barometer of how great a player is. I think we know that Jadon Sancho is a good player. I think we know he'll come straight into this Manchester United team and be effective. 120 million euros was a lot of money, and I think United were balking at that. And I can kind of understand it, even though I'm frustrated with the owners, and I don't think they spend enough money. So looks like we're going to go again this summer. Now, he's a year into his contract, so he's going to be a little bit less. You could probably, I mean, some of the figures being touted are around the 89 million pound mark, some saying 100 million, so it's still a lot of money, but we'll have to wait and see what happens with that. He's obviously got his head down, started performing to the levels that he was earlier. Whether, you know, he can maintain that, we'll see. But in the summer, fully expect Manchester United to go back in for Jadon Sancho again. But we may have to go up against a Chelsea or a Liverpool. I know Chelsea have just spent absolute fortune, but it hasn't really helped them, has it? Because they're still pretty crap. So I expect them to spend more money because that's what they do. And also, the Scousers are probably going to be spending some money in the summer because they didn't have a massive summer, the one just gone. I know they brought in Thiago Alcantara and Diogo Jota, so they did spend money, but it wasn't a big one. And it wouldn't be surprised if they went in for a marquee signing, especially as some have said that maybe someone like Mo Salah or someone like that could be moving on. So Jadon Sancho could rumble on. I'm going to get involved in the comments. Someone's saying here that, Mr. Motti, I like your formality. This is from AEIFM. Although we have a few injuries, Burnley might be without up to 7 first-team players tomorrow. So, yeah, Burnley are in a bit of a pickle there. They could be missing several players as well. I mean, you know, we know what's going on there with the sort of... There's not just the fact that there's COVID problems going on as well and injuries piling up. There's been the FA Cup. Burnley obviously had to play. I think they went to extra time and the penalties against MK Dons. Ethan Laird, talking about loanees, was obviously one of the players that featured MK Dons and went on a great run at one point as well. It was great to see. They could be without players. They could be with some side players as well. So Manchester United's 3 injuries in the grand scheme of things isn't like, oh my God, we've got 3 injuries against Burnley, 2 of whom, you know, you're not even certain are going to play. But you know, it is a slight worry when you're in a title race when you start getting players that you rate or that do feature not playing as well. Brad Van Zijt saying Salah won't go. Yeah, regardless of whether Salah goes or not, I wouldn't be surprised though if someone like Liverpool, this is a reference to the fact that I said that maybe Salah could go out and Liverpool could come in for Jadon Sancho. Even if Salah doesn't go, I wouldn't be surprised if someone like Liverpool or Chelsea or even both of them came in for Jadon Sancho, or maybe even you know, a Barcelona or a Real Madrid coming for him. I mean, a player like that, a talent like that, a youngster like that, you know, he's going to have suitors. And I said, I think that a lot of clubs were just put off last summer because of the pandemic and the price tag, whereas United still thought, okay, maybe we can get Dortmund down. Clubs might go looking at it this time and think, do you know what? It's worth it. It's worth taking a punt, especially if the price has come down. So we'll have to wait and see on that one. But yeah, it could be a bidding war. And if you are just joining us, the sort of the bidding war I was talking about, or the battle in the title, was for a youngster that United have basically been linked with, a young lad, alongside Paris Saint-Germain, been linked with a young Brest midfielder, Romain Faivre. So that's what that's about. We could be going toe-to-toe with Paris Saint-Germain for that one. So guys, do get involved in the comments. I'm going to read through them before I start wrapping up. Someone's saying, no mention of Crawley. I'm not going to mention the fact Crawley Town beat Leeds United 3-0, because this isn't about Leeds United, and I'm not going to rub salt in the wound, because they're obviously hurting, and I don't like to dwell on that fact. Someone else saying, Maurice Varela, if we can have an easy win against Burnley, or injuries or not, you take it. Yes, I would. I mean, the big game, obviously, or the sort of the massive game is Liverpool this weekend, and that's the one everyone's going to be watching. But Burnley's a difficult game, man, and we can't be going into that Burnley game taking anything for granted. It's a difficult place to go to, Turf Moor, and if you go in, if you sort of don't get a result there, and then you're going into the Liverpool game. You know, you're going into that Liverpool game on a bit of a downer, aren't you? And it's like, you know, I think we've got the table. You can see from the table, if you bring the table up, you know, Manchester United are right in the title race in a minute. I know it's only early doors, but for the first time since Sir Alex Ferguson retired, we're in a title race. People will go, well, we finished second under Jose Mourinho. We were 19 points behind City. Yeah. As soon as Manchester City beat us at Old Trafford that season, which I think was it was about 12 games in, the title was over. The title race was over. That was it. We were done. I think we went 10 points behind him then. We were never in it. Now we're in it. You look at that and you think, okay, we beat Burnley. We can, you know, obviously go above. We can go top. So it's a title race and you want your players fit for it, and we're in it. But we can't take any game for granted. I know I'm getting all the cliches out here, but you know what this league's like, and you've seen it this season as well. Look at the points this season compared to previous seasons. Previous seasons, you've seen title-winning teams finish on 98, 99, 100 points. Not happening this season, because it's much tighter, because teams are taking points off one another. So you can't just go into the Burnley game thinking, oh, it's only Burnley. We'll just do him. It's not going to happen. I'm just going to go into the comments. Darren Prendergast says, what's the weather like in Manchester today? Mild, Darren. Harris Baig says, do you reckon we will actually sign someone? In January, I'm not so sure. We spoke to, and I keep banging on about it, but we did an interview with him just for this point, Fabrizio Romano, and asked him about January. And he said, don't be surprised if Manchester United don't sign anyone in January. He said summer is the sort of time he expects a lot of these deals to be done again. He expects us to go in for maybe someone like Deo Upamecano, Jadon Sancho, some of the longer-term targets we've been linked with. Maybe this young lad, Romain Faivre from Brest, might be an option in summer. But don't expect too much in the January transfer window, because I know I was hoping that we could go in January because we're in a title race. I thought maybe we could be sort of thinking, right, do you know what? Actually, we're doing so well in the league. Let's go for it. Let's go for it in the transfer window. But no, the club are sticking to their plans, and those plans don't involve a big signing this January. I hope I'm wrong, and I hope we bring someone in, but I just don't expect it. Also, a bit of news. Someone's asked in the comments about Tim Fosu-Mensah. We've just seen an update that's just dropped. I think it's the Manchester Evening News. But, you know, a broken clock's right twice today. They're saying Manchester United defender Tim Fosu-Mensah is close to agreeing a move to Bayer Leverkusen. The MEN understands Fosu-Mensah is set to join Leverkusen, currently third in the Bundesliga, for a fee of around 1.5 million after he rejected United's offer of a new contract earlier this season. So Fosu-Mensah going to Leverkusen for £1.5 million. I mean, that's a bit deflating, isn't it? Do you know what I mean? Like, he's been for a lot, Fosu-Mensah. And, you know, he came through, didn't he, at the same time as Marcus. Was it around 2015, 2016? was absolutely fantastic when he came into the United team. I think it was Louis van Gaal gave him a chance. I remember a particular game at Upton Park. I think he played in midfield, if memory serves, and he was fantastic. And then he gave away the penalty in the semi-final against Everton. I don't think he played again. I think Louis van Gaal just like, that was it. That was the end of his season. And then he had a couple of loan moves. He went to Fulham, he went to Crystal Palace as well. Crystal Palace, he was kept out of the team by Aaron Wan-Bissaka. Fulham was just a bit of a nightmare. They were just rooted to the bottom of the table. Didn't really work out. Had a lot of injury issues. Came back to United and only seemed to sort of hold out an olive branch for him and say, you know, he's still got a future. Still what? So, you know, he's training with the team. He's getting better. He's getting fitter. All that sort of stuff. And then he was a surprise inclusion, wasn't he, last season? I think it was it the Palace game last season where he was in the starting 11? I might be wrong on that, but, you know, he was one of the games towards the end of last season where he came into the side. I was shocked. Couldn't believe it. Did well. And we thought, okay, looks like he might have a future here at Manchester United after all. But, again, he's not really featured, has it? And it looks like United is just sort of saying, this isn't happening. Well, it's not even United saying it's him. He's sort of saying it's not happening. He's not getting much game time. And it looks like he could be heading to Bayer Leverkusen for £1.5 million. Which, I mean, it's pennies really, isn't it? And it's a bit disappointing that that could be the end to his United career for a player that, when he burst onto the scene, you know, he did offer so much and a lot of us were very excited about him. And he didn't, you know, this is a player that had been brought in, obviously, from Holland. He'd been highly touted, he'd been highly scouted for a long time. You know, he was one of the sort of shining young players on the European scene and everyone was very excited about him. But it's one of those, you know, it's not going to happen for him. It looks like it's not going to happen for him. So we wish him well if he does move on. And I think, you know, someone's saying there, Harris Begg again, saying that's a bit of a bargain for Leverkusen. And I think it is. David Cruson says, no Pepsi Cherry Max. Not Jake, no, I'll have that later. Guys, I'm going to start wrapping that up there. So just to recap, Romain, get his name right. Romain Faivre. If I said that right, Faivre. He's been linked with a move from Brest to Manchester United, a young midfielder. Also, Paris Saint-Germain are in for him as well. So we'll have to wait and see what happens with that one. Could be a bit of a bidding war between Ole Gunnar Solskjaer and Mauricio Pochettino. Also, we've got a couple of, three injury worries ahead of the Burnley game. Paul Pogba, Luke Shaw and Victor Lindelof, all doubtful for the game. Could be having to miss that one. Hopefully they'll be back for the Scousers at the weekend though, because the games are coming thick and fast. And that one is a title 6-pointer. He's, you know, we're in a title race now. And also Jadon Sancho's been speaking out. He said about his recent form, just, you know, as we've all known, he hasn't really been replicating the form this season that he saw last season. You can see from the graphics there, but he's been speaking out and he said, obviously this season's been difficult for me. And then he just says, I went away, I just focused on my game and came back raring to go. I'm working hard every day in training and on the pitch, so I'm just happy to get my goals and assists. And also we had a little bit of breaking news that Tim Fosu-Mensah could be on his way to Bayer Leverkusen for £1.5 million. Hey, who'd have thunk it? You can get players from Manchester United for £1.5 million, an absolute snip. But we know that Tim Fosu-Mensah has had his injury problems, hasn't played a lot of football, has had a couple of loan moves that didn't really work out. So it looks like Manchester United and Tim Fosu-Mensah could finally be parting ways permanently. Guys, thanks for all your comments. Thanks as well. If you're not done, hit the like button. Hit subscribe as well if you're not subscribing. Also, if you're not a member, check out the member section. We've got loads of new content coming up there. Some extra content for you guys. And also, we'll be running prize giveaways. We've just given away a PlayStation 5. So check out the member section as well. We'll have loads of it coming up today. You'll have the Premier League piss take with Adam McCullough and Joe Smith as well. I know a lot of guys love that. We missed out last week, so it's back this week. We'll also have the Stretford Paddock podcast, where it's going to be myself, Stephen Howson, Adam McCullough and Joe Smith. And then we'll be looking ahead towards tomorrow's big title. I won't say title deciding, but, you know, title important game at Burnley. So we'll have the preview for that. And obviously tomorrow we'll have the watch along and the fan cams and all the live reaction as well. So make sure you are subscribing to Stretford Paddock. I've been Jay Moy. This has been the Paper Talk Live. Thanks for watching.